Cashflow Diary Podcast, episode 115.
Welcome to yet another exciting episode of the Cashflow Diary Podcast, the podcast that teaches you insider tips, tactics, and strategies for creating leveraged streams of cash flow into your life. Learn from top-performing entrepreneurs, business owners, investors, and thought leaders from across the globe as they share their secrets to success. Like what you learn on this and other Cashflow Diary podcast episodes? Go to learninvestingnow.com and sign up to receive powerful tips and information that will help you succeed as an entrepreneur and investor. Now, here's your host, investor, entrepreneur, business owner, educator, speaker, author, and master facilitator of Robert Kiyosaki's Cashflow Game, Jay Massey.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode of the Cashflow Diary Podcast. I am your host, Jay Massey, and I am glad that you are here. And here's why. Because you may be of the opinion that there is only one way to do real estate. And what I'm going to tell you today is, well, there are many, many, many ways to do real estate. And today's guest is definitely going to enlighten all of us with a different strategy that I don't actually do, that you guys may be interested in to go out there and begin to build cash flow. So keep this in mind. Cash flow can come, obviously, from passive investments. It can also come from building a business, and doesn't mean that the business has to be something other than real estate. You can build a business inside real estate that is all about providing clean, safe, affordable housing, but to a different type of customer who's today's guest absolutely serves. And I am so glad that you guys continue to come here to hear all of the resources that we are searching and scouring the planet to find. So I appreciate you listening, and I just wanted to make sure that you understood that. Now, today's guest, here's what I love. I love the fact that in the United States, in the world, as a human being, someone who is capable of making a decision, it is so not about what happens, but how you respond to what is happening to you, that it makes a big difference in where you eventually end up. Could you imagine actually figuring this real estate thing out, having the fun that you imagine is possible because it's there, and then losing it all? Would you quit that first time? Maybe. What about if you said, you know what, I'm going to build it back up again. And you're like, okay, cool, I'm there. And then it went away again. What would you do this second time? Would you quit or would you keep going? It's one of the things that I love is that story of perseverance, because as we all know, suffering leads to perseverance, perseverance, character, character, hope. And what today's guest is going to do, I believe, is give you hope that you can absolutely get this done too, no matter where you're starting from, because you know what? I was talking about him. He's been there more than once, and he's come back from the ashes. He's the phoenix that has risen twice. Help me welcome Mr. Nick Ruiz. Nick, you there?
Jay Massey, I love it, brother. I really, really enjoyed that introductory commentary. Honestly, beautiful, beautiful.
Thank you. You call the phoenix that's risen twice often?
Not too often. Not too often. That was beautiful. So we're doing good here.
That's good. That's good. So one of the things that I do is that I view today's entrepreneurs a lot like yesterday's superheroes. You know, we come up, we develop products and services and solutions to help our customers in various different ways. And you've done this for a long time, longer than me, in fact. And what I'd love to know, though, is like, just like in superhero world, you know, they all always have an alter ego, a beginning story. They didn't start out with their superpowers, understanding everything that they understand with all their wisdom. They were someone else at the beginning. What I'd love to know is, before you've been through all of this journey, before you were an aspiring author about to release your book and all that other stuff, before all of that, who was Nick Ruiz?
Well, I was an entrepreneur, Jay, as long as I can remember. I connect the dots now that I'm older, but looking back, I always loved to buy and sell. I don't know if it was in my DNA, but I love the idea of buying low and selling high. Did it through grade school, middle school, high school. Got in a lot of trouble in high school doing that. People would give me their pagers and CD players back then, and I'd sell them. And it was just a lot of fun. And I got some kind of thrill out of it. But it was all nickel and dime stuff. I was a kid. You know, I wasn't surviving, you know, and making a full-time living. But what I knew was I wanted to put my own stake in the ground and do my own thing. Didn't know what it was going to be. You know, when I was a teenager, I tried a lot of MLM or network marketing businesses, which I'm sure many of you listening know, where you go out, you sell, you recruit people and all that kind of stuff. And nothing wrong with those businesses, but it burns you out. And I have to say, I learned a lot from those businesses, though, about getting out of my comfort zone, meeting new people, gaining quick rapport with people, salesmanship. So that's one key trait, obviously, Jay, as you know, is pretty much core for entrepreneurship, no matter what industry you're in. You got to be able to work with people, right? Real estate is a people business. The houses are how we transact. That's kind of how I say it, and that's how I see it. But yeah, so all of a sudden, you know, late night infomercial, I'm 19 years old. I see something for no money down real estate, and I didn't have any money to put down or invest into it. So I'm like, okay, it was a $250 course. They send you a bunch of workbooks in the mail and DVDs, and I put my credit card up and bought it and went through the whole program, devoured it quickly. I'm an obsessive kind of dude. You know, within a couple of days, I think I took down, I don't know how many booklets, but whatever. The bottom line is I took it down fast, but I couldn't really act on it. You know, I was like, a lot of these strategies are really far-fetched. They want the seller to fly to the moon and back, and then I'll buy the house. Like, weird stuff where I'm just like, no one's going to go for this. So I put it away thinking, you know what, maybe I should try another business. I'll look into some new stuff. But I knew real estate was a great business. In fact, it's one of the oldest wealth-building principle models in the world, however you want to call it, and it always will be. People are always going to be creating wealth with real estate, and there's a million ways to cut the pie, which is what you alluded to earlier in the introductory. So all of a sudden I'm like, you know what, let me try something. I pull the program out. I try to grab a couple quick strategies, and I went out and I found a deal, and I creatively set it up to where it was a duplex, and I rented out both units for $500 a month, nothing out of my pocket. And I was making $500 a month. Light bulb. Aha. Okay. Maybe I should do this more. You know, let me buy another one. And I was able to borrow against that one and buy another one. Now I was making $1,000 a month, and I was like 20 or 21 years old. That's not riches, but I'll tell you what, $1,000 a month passively at that age for me was like total, like, oh my God, I'm in love with this business. How do I do more? The problem, Jay, was though, I ran out of borrowing ability really quick. So right now I'm sitting with these two places, $1,000 a month, great, but I knew I wanted to grow. I'm like, I want to go big. So I sold the first property, walked away with $22,000 cash. Couple months later, so the second property, walked away with almost $35,000 cash, and then I was like super hooked, because $1,000 a month, yeah, but when someone hands you a check, especially that young, for $35,000, like bam, you can put that in your bank. That's like a shot of adrenaline. So from there, I started buying and selling. You know, I bought and sold over 200 properties, created a multi-million-dollar net worth, and then 2008 happened. And it all came to a crashing halt, and we can go into that. And it forced me into bankruptcy. But I mainly am a single family guy. I buy them, I rent them, I rehab them, I sell them, I wholesale them, which was another aspect of the business, which I am in love with, especially for new people where you don't need any cash or credit. So, but I'm mainly a single family guy. It's been serving me well. Nothing against any other types of investment models. They all work. It's just that's what I gravitate towards, and that's what works for me. And yeah, so then I went into bankruptcy, and I, you know, we can go into how I came out of that, or if you want to touch on anything I already talked about, you tell me.
Got it. Well, the thing that I think is the most important for everyone to understand, especially given today's day and age, we've got to catch them up. And there were these things called pagers. You wore them on your hip. I'm sure some people are like, what's a pager?
I know. See, Discman? What's a Discman?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. I thought I should maybe touch on that, but I'm like, I don't know. There's probably a mixed crowd, but I'm sure there are listeners who don't have any clue what that is, believe it or
right
not. Yeah.
Before the cell phone, there was this other device that was not as efficient in any way, shape, or form.
Right.
But we like them no matter what. We still have
I found my first house out of local newspaper ad. I mean, that sounds outrageous nowadays. I mean, who looks through the paper? So that's another funny little interlude there.
You're like a physical, but they have these things? Yes, no. It didn't just come to you in a text message? It wasn't on Google? No,
right,
no,
right.
No. Yeah. Totally understood. I just want to make sure we don't leave anybody behind
when
we talk about that. But one of the things that you mentioned that I absolutely agree with is where you got your, we'll call it your business education. One of the greatest things that I appreciate about network marketing in and of itself, it is a business school, period. Yes. It is one of the best ones because it's not based upon theory. It is your lab. It is the lab experiment in so many ways. And it's interesting what it puts you through. And more importantly, you do it because of who it's going to make of you so that you can finally, maybe that is your thing and you could one day just do great things there. But I know so many people who leveraged those types of opportunities into something else. But that first opportunity with the network marketing company or companies in some cases is where they, you know, exercised or where they got rid of all those rough spots that helped them to become awesome in so many ways.
You put that absolutely perfectly, Jay. Sorry to interrupt, but that's it. The way you said it was exactly what was in my brain. Yes, you hit it on the head. It was a straight up business lab. And like you said, no theory. They push you out on the street, quote unquote, and say, hey, go make it happen. You're on your own, more or less. If you want to make money, it's all on your effort. So it forces you out there, forces you, you know, online, everyone talks about like business funnels and all these funnels. Well, years ago, the funnel started with going to Barnes and Noble. Hey, going to the business section, literally, this is a strategy they taught you, which is amazing, really, if you think about it. You go into the business book section.
Yes.
You know where I'm going already.
I do.
So you see someone reading a business book and you kind of casually start a conversation. You shake their hand. Hi, I'm Nick. Oh, you're so-and-so. What are you reading? Da, da, da. Oh, you're into business too? And, you know, then you exchange business cards and say, hey, maybe we'll catch lunch sometime. Then you call them, you set them up, and you go to lunch. You buy them lunch, or they buy you lunch, or you split it down the middle, whatever it may be, because you both have, you know, mutual interests. And then all of a sudden, you call them again. Hey, do you want to meet me and come to this meeting? This and that. That was the old school, quote unquote, marketing funnel. And it really taught you how to gain sincere rapport. We're not manipulating. It taught you how to make friends, because that's what business is about, making new friends, gaining real relationships, not fake ones. I mean, that you can just exploit or extort. These are real relationships. And that's what it really taught me. So you're right. You hit it on the head. It is a straight up business personability lab without question. I love it.
And that's the thing that I believe that makes the difference. I've said this before, and I want to get your opinion because you are deep into the real estate world as well. I say the difference between paper assets and real assets is the fact that you have to learn interpersonal skills. If all I'm going to do is trade stock, I got to make sure I know how to hit the any key. That's really what I got to know how to do. I don't have to know how to actually talk to a person and actually develop that relationship, because the relationship's with technology or my computer per se. And I don't necessarily need interpersonal skills. I might need some intrapersonal skills, you know, to manage my own emotions. But at the end of the day, I think that's the key advantage for most successful real estate investors. Would you agree?
Absolutely. I really think real estate is a people. I don't think, I know it. I've been doing it long enough, and I'm sure you can agree. Real estate is a people business. No matter if you're buying apartment buildings, single families, you are buying things from sellers. You're selling things to buyers. You're dealing with realtors. You're dealing with title companies. I just met actually an owner of a new title company that has some things for me, and I'm going to push some things his way. And I took him out to lunch today. Like, it's a brand new relationship, and I am so excited because we're both going to be helping each other out. I'm not trying to milk him for anything. He's not trying to milk me. We are going to have awesome exchanges where I'm going to throw some deals his way. He's going to throw some stuff my way. And to me, it's just so exciting, you know, like, but it's a people business. It's all people. The houses are just the things we trade at the end of the day. But if you don't have the people stuff on the front end, you're not going to be trading any money for houses and houses for money. That's just that simple.
I agree. And here's the funny thing here's what I think I find very ironic. You and I know this. We try to tell people this. But yet the first thing they ask us is, show me how to write the offer. I'm like, okay, how about we work on finding people and developing relationships, or they think the way to build the relationship is by paying someone to be on the team. Do you have, and I'm just curious because I really don't know this answer, there are some people I know that are a part of my team that are looking well beyond just the compensation as for the reason why they're there. Is that true for you as well?
As far as why people are on, like the people I deal with?
Yes.
Well, it comes down to relationships. I mean, and going back to what you said here, you know, how do I write the offer? I feel like if you have all your relationships in place and you have, you know, different teammates that you've built and, you know, in nurtured these relationships, offer writing is not going to be a big deal. There's going to be people to help you. And to me, it's just all relationships. I feel like a lot of problems slowly evaporate when you have quality relationships around you. And you're just going to have a lot less bumps in the road. When you say, oh, yeah, hey, Johnny, remember that thing we were talking about? You know, you mind giving me a hand on this or vice versa? It's just the law of life. It goes beyond business, you know?
I agree 100%. And then you brought up something that I think many people have as a common thought process in their mind. They think in order to have real estate or business, one person has to win, the other has to lose. I think you said he's not trying to milk me, I'm not trying to milk him was the words that you actually used. But the concept there being that somebody has to take advantage or get advantage of over someone in order for me to succeed. I sense that you don't believe that's true. I know I don't believe that's true. So what is true?
Well, what is true is there is a win-win deal for the majority of real estate transactions out there. And, you know, if you can create those deals, that's a sustainable business. If you want to manipulate someone and you know, skin somebody, you know, there's a saying, what, you can shear a sheep 1,000 times, skin them only once. Listen, yeah, you can skin somebody in this game and, you know, make a score. But long term, that's not a sustainable business model. You will not make this long. If you're looking for long term cash flow slash wealth, you know, create win-wins. You're going to get referrals. And this goes for any industry. I don't care what business you're in. You know, that's how things truly grow in an organic way, is by not exploiting or extorting anybody and simply creating win-wins. And most real estate transactions have that ability available. You're solving a problem of a seller, as a buyer in this case. You know, I'm looking for more deals. There are sellers out there who just need their problem solved and their house to be gotten rid of. And I give you money, I solve your problem, you give me property. You solve my problem of needing more. It's truly a win-win. And price, you know, if I make an offer to purchase for, you know, $50,000, you know, that seller looks at their problems, looks at their big picture, and maybe it is worth 90 or 100, you know, so it is discounted. But they're making a decision based off of this global landscape picture that I don't even know about. So maybe they have to move to Florida to help their aunt who's dying. And that $50,000 offer is actually the greatest thing that came their way so they can move forward in their landscape picture. So in the immediate, it may say, hey, it may look like, you know, there's a huge discount there, which there may be, but that's part of this business. But again, I'm solving a global problem for that seller that may not be apparent. And they wouldn't be signing my contract and pursuing this deal if it wasn't a win for them. So I think that's a really good point, Jay, that you brought up with this. It's not a winner and loser scenario. You know, again, everyone has this huge picture of their life and their plans and their goals. It's like the stock market, for example. It's a, you know, you brought that up. I buy a stock for $5 and someone might have just bought it for $1 yesterday and made $4 off of me. That might look outrageous. That guy just scalped you. No, no, no. But this company, I'm not buying it to resell it tomorrow for $9 and make the same kind of money he did. I'm buying it because in 30 years, I know it's going to be worth $40. I mean, that's kind of a nice analogy to approach it. My global picture is different than his immediate picture. And that's why there's so many ways to put together deals, because so many people have different global pictures of what they need and what their goals are, that you can always find things to connect to. That's kind of the way I like to look at it.
You know, Nick, I am so glad you said it that way, because I've tried to communicate that idea a number of times. But this concept of the global picture, we don't know what's going on. I mean, because we're looking at it from our point of view going, you just took advantage of them because that property is, quote unquote, worth more. Well, it may be it has a higher value, but at that exact moment, it's worth what I'm willing to pay for it and what they're willing to sell it for. And you brought up the greatest point ever. It's not like we're holding a gun to their head saying, sign the contract or else. It's totally voluntary.
It's absolutely voluntary. And again, their goals are beyond us a lot of the time. You know, as buyers, we try to extract as much information out of them as possible to be able to solve the problem and tailor the deal the best way possible. A lot of people have personal things that they keep in and don't want to talk about, but they're selling for a reason. Like I said, they may have some different things they need to do in their life, and liquidating this property gives them ultimate freedom for that point in their life. And again, that I don't know where exactly they're coming from, but if they're willing to sell it to me at that price, chances are it's to their benefit to do so. So it is a win-win, and that's the beauty of this business. That kind of stuff is all over the place, and those kind of people are all over the place looking for solutions like you alluded to earlier. We're problem solvers. It's just that simple.
It is, and indeed, I tell people all the time, they're like, Jay, where's the deals at? And I'm like, the problem is you're looking for deals. What you got to be doing is looking for problems, not properties, and you'll start to find the deals. One of the things that you said that I want to bring up and also highlight is many people believe, at least, I'm going to, quote unquote, find or run into a deal. You said the word create. I like that word. Because I believe that that's where the money is. So help me, help us understand how you see the process of the deal. You know, where does the deal come from in the first place?
Are you tired of letting good cash flow generating ideas go to waste? Go to cashflowdiary.com/ready to apply for a complimentary. Yes, that means free one-on-one breakthrough session. Take action now. Go to cashflowdiary.com/ready. Again, that's cashflowdiary.com/ready. Before we get back to today's episode of the Cashflow Diary podcast, your host, Jay Massey, has some important insights to share with you.
Okay. Many of you know we have started and launched our multifamily mastermind group. You can go to cashflowdiary.com/multifamily, cashflowdiary.com/multifamily if you want to know more about it. And what's interesting is that in that process, we were able to get come up with a contest, and people were sharing and all these other things. So a number of you, yes, we know we have entered. And if you've been paying attention, or maybe not, you did not know that we have a web show, cashflowdiary.tv, cashflowdiary.tv. And if you haven't, you're wondering, did I win? Well, you have to go watch cashflowdiary.tv. You'll be able to see the episode and the announcement of who won. For those of you wondering, what on earth was the contest about? It was simple. All you had to do was share her information from the link that we provided. And what happened is the three individuals are chosen to win their choice of a LiveScribe pen, a device I absolutely love. And then secondly, a iPhone 6 plus 16 gigabyte. Yep. And then the 16 gigabyte version of the iPad 2 Air Wi-Fi only. So they get to win their choices. If you're wondering, did I win? Well, you head over to cashflowdiary.tv to make that happen. In the meantime, have you noticed just how many similarities there are between people who get deals done and the ones that don't? Man, this interview with Nick is awesome. Let's get back to it.
Well, there's a lot of ways I put myself out there and market myself to people that have problems, like you said, whether it's inheriting a property, a divorce, vacant properties, bad tenant kind of properties, violations, and just tough scenarios where I know there's a chance that they may have a problem. So then they contact me, and then they tell me about their goals and what they need to get out of it. And I think, there's a couple ways we can go about it. Sometimes I can say, okay, I'll write you a check. Here's the number. You agree. Let's call it a day, and I'll pay cash, and we'll make the deal happen. But here's an example. There was a single family residence that this guy really wanted to sell. And he, again, some people's goals are monetary. Sometimes it's this, sometimes it's that. This particular guy needed $20,000 for the single family home. And I just, I said I can't get above 15, you know, and that only sounds like 5,000, but you know, if you on a percentage basis, that's a large percentage increase in price that I didn't feel it was totally justified. It needed some work. And you know, my numbers, as generous as I wanted to be to this guy, I said, Bob, I said, I cannot go a dime over 15. And then he's like, okay, well, I am firm. I said, can you meet me in the middle? I was trying to think of anything. Or no, I didn't say meet me in the middle. In fact, I was at like 12 and 15 was coming there. So let me take that back. And he's like, Nick, I need $20,000 because that's just what I need for what I put into it, for what my family put into it, or whatever it was. So I go, okay, Bob. I said, let me think on this for a minute. I'm going to try to get creative here. So after putting like a day's worth of thought into it, I call him back. I say, listen, Bob, here's the deal. I cannot write you a check for $20,000. I just can't justify doing it because my math and numbers don't get me there. I said, but I'll tell you what, my money's valuable in my pocket because it allows me to do other deals. And, it, you know, obviously cash is king. So if I can keep, you know, money in my pocket, there's value there. So I said, how about I write you a check for $5,000 and I write you three more checks for $5,000 once a year for 3 years, and I'll get you your 20. Now that nice. allowing me to break it, and we agreed on that, and that was the deal.
Nice.
It was kind of a custom land contract. Instead of monthly payments, I said, I'll make you yearly payments, $5,000 a year. That allowed me to keep $15,000 more in my pocket, which may allow me to write a check for 15 for a place that may be worth 30 or 35. So right. If I buy a place that's worth 35, I just made $20,000,
right.
but I gave up five by paying him 25 more than I wanted to.
Right.
So I gave up $5,000 to make 20 more. I thought that was a pretty solid creative thing. He gets his 20 for his just stubborn goal that he had to have, which
right.
I can't knock him for it. That's what he wanted, and he stood firm on it. So I think that's the kind of creation of deals that I'm talking about here, where I won because I was able to take that 15 and invest it somewhere else that would make me more, but I gave up five to do that. I mean, I think that's kind of a good example of a creation of a win-win deal.
I think that's absolutely perfection in so many ways, because for those who understand the technical version of what he just did there, I mean, when we talk about the time value of money, money today is always worth more than money tomorrow, especially in an inflationary economy. We're not going to talk about inflation today, but you get my point there. And then secondly, for those of you who picked up on it, he just negotiated a 0% interest loan for 3 years. And you're like, these things don't exist. Yes,
yeah.
They do. It's in the language. And understanding that, he understood that the guy was after $20,000. Great.
Yes.
Get him $20,000. He didn't ever say when he needed it. He just said he needed $20,000. And that is exactly the type of stuff that you must become good at as a real estate investor to understand how to still solve the problem.
And absolutely.
That, I mean, that's the stuff. You see, you get me all kinds of excited because this is the stuff I love to do.
Jay, that's awesome. And I get hyped up too. I mean, you and I could probably pause this recording and go on for 12 hours on this stuff. But I want to throw in this. I have to say this because the most outrageous deal I've ever done, and out of all the interviews I've done, I don't know if I've thrown this one in there, but it just brought this up. I was about 22 years old. There was a property. The guy was asking $59,000. I'll make it quick, but he was asking $59,000 and it needed a ton of work. Mm-hmm. I offered him $62,000.
Yep.
Zero down land contract.
Yep.
And 0% interest.
Yep.
And zero payments, Jay, for 1 year. So I closed on it on, I think it was March 1st, back in the early 2000s. And the first check I had to write to him was March 1st of the following year. You want to talk? I actually hired an attorney. This was way early in the day. It was when I really didn't know what I was doing. So I'm like, I want to have him write this land contract up.
Right.
This was like some old veteran real estate attorney. He goes, in all my decades of doing this, I think he's been an attorney for like 35, 40 years in real estate. He's like, of all the deals I've ever seen, I've never seen a seller sign an offer like this. He goes, this is outrageous. But the seller had a goal. I solved that goal and, you know, created a deal that made sense for me and it made sense for the seller. So for those of you listening, like Jay, you just said, there's not many excuses to be made. Creating a win-win deal is possible. It's just look in the right places, and be patient and work with people and people. Gain rapport with these sellers. So I just had to throw that in there. I didn't want to go too long on that, but I had to throw that in. I love it.
That's the stuff that people think is not possible, not probable, that they think is the pie in the sky. Oh, that only happens once in a while. Well, maybe, or it can happen a whole lot to you if you have your marketing on straight. And most importantly, you know when to hear what that sounds like. I love deal creation. We could hit pause and talk for another 12 hours. But let's switch a little bit of gears, because I've got to understand something. I've only been doing this a few years, and you know, we started out at single family houses, did the wholesaling thing, had lots of those and did hundreds of deals there, went over to notes, and now we've got, you know, commercial buildings, cell phone towers, and we're building a resort. How on earth can you manage to love single family houses? I gotta understand the way you think about this.
Okay. Well, there's a lot of reasons. I love singles for, let's start talking about them real fast here. So number one, no common areas. I deal with nothing. Okay. I deal with zero trash, zero common utilities, zero common hallways to vacuum. And again, I'm not knocking those things, because those headaches are paid. You get paid for those headaches when you own those things, because there's profit in owning them. So let me be clear. I in no way don't. You know, I love all the different aspects of real estate. I have friends making fortunes. And like we talked about, there's a dozen ways to cut the real estate pie. Single families for me, though. So let me go back into why I love singles. No common areas. No tenants that can argue with each other, get in fights, complain about each other. And, you know, bed bugs, for example. I have a friend who owns a 48-unit building. One tenant brought in bed bugs.
Yeah.
All 48 dominoes. I don't know if you've dealt with bed bugs, but it's a very expensive.
We had
bed bugs is a very expensive extermination, especially when you're talking 48 units. I think he paid like $3,000 a month for 16 months or something outrageous. But the point is, no common areas. Another reason, tenants pay all utilities. I pay zero. I pay zero utilities. They pay all heat, electric, water, and everything like that. Okay. Another reason, they never move. I have zero turnover. I mean, I'm talking virtually zero turnover. Tenants don't move. It's a single family. It's their house. Okay. They're always in demand. Where I'm at, they're always in demand. People line up around the block. So it allows me to be extra, extra picky with my tenants, because I know I have the upper hand, because I have this single family gold that everybody wants. Another thing, I love the liquidity. The classic three bedroom single family, I can peddle those anytime I want to, and I'm going to be able to get full retail dollar, because it's going to be Johnny and Sally homeowner who want to move into it. Right. And actually selling them to tenants gives me, the ability to get top dollar. You know, the liquidity of multifamily, 10, 20, 40, 100 unit buildings.
Right.
You can't put a for sale sign up and, you know, close on it a month later with the buyer at top dollar. Usually it's going to be a savvy entrepreneur. And again, there's a whole different group of fortunes to be made in that world. But what I've just learned is they're very, very liquid. I love the liquidity. You know, if I ever get a little short on cash, hey, I'll peddle these two places. And, you know, now I'm boom through the roof again or whatever it may be. But there's more reasons, but I just really like, here's what I love. I love the very, very autopilot scenario of them for me. And again, many people have mastered the autopilot-ness of multis, but for me, it's so hands-off because it's their home. I get less repair calls, and you know, if the door creaks, they don't want to bother me, because they know for me to come out there, I might get mad at them, and then I might make them move out of that golden single family that they have. So it's just, I don't want to show units. I don't want to have my manager, anybody. I don't want to have constantly be showing units. People don't move. So I have to say, you know, between the zero utilities, not moving, the liquidity, and, you know, there's probably a couple other things. People really make it their home. They plant the garden in back. They have family barbecues there. And it's just, that's why I love them.
That's funny. You bring up the zero utilities. That was one of my major reasons for switching over to some commercial assets, is to do triple nets so that I could have some of the same benefits that I've got in the the multifamily space, but also get rid of the utility aspect. So that's
triple pretty, net's and, beautiful.
Yeah,
beautiful.
I'm happy there. So that's so funny because you bring up the stuff that, yeah, those are the headaches that we get the privilege of dealing with in my world. Got it. You're a single family guy. And that's cool. And that's one of the things that I want to stress to everybody. Look, this real estate pie, as Nick talks about, it's so huge. You can't even begin to imagine. I mean, Nick could go do another 200-300 deals and, you know what, it wouldn't even show up on a statistic.
Yeah, right.
And, right. But to him personally, oh my God, that's incredible. And that's one of the things that I love is that when we're out there helping people, we get the privilege of telling them, look, you could go do 100 deals. It's not going to like affect me, because one of the things I get is like, Jay, you're creating all this competition. I'm like, not really. You don't understand. There's so much out there. It's ridiculous. And I know you're doing the same thing. You've got a new book coming out. So tell us a little bit about what prompted you to write it. What's in it? Who's it for? And most importantly, what I'm going to learn when I go through it.
Absolutely. And I want to touch on the single family, and the book goes into this too. But another reason which just came to my mind is the fact that when I lock up a single family under contract, where someone signs a contract, you know, I just have these options in front of me. I can, you know, do the bare minimum and rent it. I can rehab it and sell it. Or you know what? I'm a little tied up right now with a couple deals. Maybe I'll wholesale this to one of these investor buddies that I know. It's just so like open. I call it the triad. You know, you can wholesale, you can rehab and sell, or you can rent it. So that's a fun thing. You know, you just, there's always options on what you can do with it, depending on your exact, you know, global scenario in your business. But as far as the book, so I came up from scratch, started as a teenager by, you know, mid-20s, you know, had a net worth of almost $2 million. 2008 took me down. I immediately, and I filed bankruptcy, like real bankruptcy, right? I came back after bankruptcy with financial independence again as a real estate entrepreneur, single families, because I really was backed against the wall. I was raising a family. And frankly, I believe that when you're backed up against the wall is when you actually take the most possible action with anything, because you're forced into it. We're creatures of force. We hire personal trainers because we don't want to do those last two reps. I mean, it's just that simple. Like, we need to be pushed. And when you are back in the corner, you have no choice. You know, you want to take the island, burn the boats. You know what I mean? Right. So that's where I was at. I had a family to support. So I didn't have many resources, but I became extremely resourceful. And right. You know, that's the key. So I started doing deals again, and I made it. And, you know, I don't know who I was talking to, but I kind of realized someone was kind of mentioning things, and it kind of light bulbs went up in my head. I kind of had a little story to tell, you know, because I came up from scratch as a youngin, did all my stuff, made lots of mistakes, believe, spending crazy money, doing dumb stuff. When you're young and have that kind of money in your early and mid-20s, it gets insane. So I did plenty of stupid things I don't even want to talk about. But and then it took me down to the bottom. You know, it taught me a lot of things. I call it a super experience. I say going through the bankruptcy was miserable, gut-wrenching. I wish it on nobody. Honestly, it's a nightmare going to the court, having nothing, you know, telling my wife to put down a $2.99 bag of chips. I mean, I'm talking about real pain. We didn't need it. We're not buying it. How much are we paying for a gallon of milk? All that kind of stuff. I mean, really, really, really bad. And I'm coming from a place of serious financial abundance. So it hurt extra, extra bad. I was not used to this. So I call it a super experience. I say that bankruptcy was the best experience of my life. And that sounds crazy and controversial, but it actually was, because it way broadened my peripheral, gave me super wisdom on things I never thought I knew about. It just really taught me lessons, and it's a super experience. And the reason I call it a super experience is because as we get older, we go through experiences and we get wiser. That's why all the old people are wise, right? They've gone through way more than the young people have. Well, when you go through a super experience, I feel like it packs in maybe a decade or two of living all in one shot. And that's why I call it that. And it's kind of, it makes sense to me. And that's why I kind of call it that. So the bottom line is, and I came back again, so I'm twice self-made from scratch. Second time was after bankruptcy, when I had less financial resources than probably the majority of the people listening here. Because when you're bankrupt, there's no lower in the financial world. You're at the bottom, credit-wise, money-wise, the whole nine. So most of you listening are probably in better shoes than I was. And I was able to come back. So it's kind of like the ultimate excuse crusher. So I'm like, I got to write. I wrote a book. I'm like, this is my story. This is what I did, you know. And the story isn't all rah, 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 hype motivation, which we all love. It's kind of unique, because then I go into the nuts and bolts of how to do your first single family deal. You know, a lot of books either cover the inspiration and motivation, which is great. A lot of books are the nuts and bolts. Here's how to. I put them both into one. You know, I think it was important because, you know, you can get all hyped up at a seminar or something. And then you walk out the front door all hyped up, like, wait, scratching your head. Okay, I'm real happy right now. And I know I want to go out and dominate the world. But how do I do that? What's step one, you know, or whatever. So I combine that in the book. And it's called Flip, The Unconventional Guide to Becoming a Real Estate Entrepreneur and Building Your Dream Lifestyle. And you know what? I focus on this. And I have a chapter in the book, Jay. And the last chapter, actually, the last chapter is why I'm not focused on you making millions in quotes. That's my final chapter. And I make it really clear that this book is not cross millions off your list. It's okay to have big dreams. And I want you to have big dreams and goals. But when you're starting and a beginner, thinking about making millions is going to paralyze these initial moves you need to make. Just worry about step one. Step 100 will come. But you got to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, down the line first. And I feel like the looking at millions, just it's such a big number and big picture. Start with one deal. Because guess what? If you can do that first deal, it's rinse and repeat, baby. Like, period. Then you can do a second one. And then you can start scaling. Do your first deal. And that's what this book really focuses on. How do you do your first profitable deal? And you don't need cash or credit to do it, period. And it, you know,
I love it. If I didn't know any better, I'd say we were related.
Yeah, I think I kind of get that vibe here too. It's like, yeah, we were connecting here. It's the same page, big time.
Crazy. It's just crazy. But hopefully, what that means is that there's commonalities. I mean, you guys, you know the stories. There's commonalities even in our stories. There's commonalities in how we attacked them. There's commonalities in why we took action and what made us do it. And I hope that everyone listening takes license from that. That yes, it can be done. You just have to put yourself in the state required to do the works that you're already capable of doing. And for us, it took, we'll call it a super experience,
yes,
in our cases to make that work. So, and that's just the way it is. That's just the way it is. So you've been out there, you've seen a number of people, you've been in this for decades. My question is, what do you see as the number one reason people don't actually take the actions that you know that need to happen?
I think nowadays, especially, the problem is with the internet schemes out there and everything else. I really think it's a problem that all these guys online are selling these push button, let's flip houses in our underwear. All you got to do is click a mouse BS. And the problem is it's putting this message out there that it doesn't take real work and that it's not a real business. Let me be crystal freaking clear here. This is a real business that requires real energy and effort. And I got news for you. If you're working 40 hours and you think, you know, you're already working hard, I don't have time to do it. To do this business, you better start stopping watching TV. You need to make sacrifices, especially in the beginning, and put real hours into finding deals, creating deals, you know, developing relationships. This business takes work. Now, the beauty of this business is once you start nurturing these relationships and doing more deals, there seems to be some type of flow where as you grow, things do become easier and smoother. But make no mistake about it, this is a real business that takes real work, but it can be very rewarding. It's extremely fun as you progress. And I'm sure, Jay, you know, I mean, it's a blast. And yes, right before you hit record, I told you this week I've had some nightmare headaches that's going on. But the global picture is clear. This is a great business. Listen, I haven't missed one of my daughter's field trips. I have two daughters. I go to everything. It gives you flexibility. You make your own schedule. I mean, the list goes on and on. I had lunch today with a great new contact, which I mentioned earlier, that owns a title company. We're going to start working together. Like, I can do that. And you, whoever's listening, yeah, it's possible, but you do have to put in the work. There is no put in the real estate business. There is no click a button, flip houses in your underwear. Not going to happen.
I know. People ask me all the time, what software do I need to find deals? I'm like, you're 2 feet in a networking event.
Bingo. Bingo. Yes. That's the best answer you could have given them. Absolutely.
It's like, it just doesn't happen that way. I mean,
you're asking the wrong question, buddy, is really the problem. You're asking the wrong question.
What is the question they should be asking?
Well, number one, not what software should I be using, but the question is, you know, if they're coming to you as like you're a mentor, for example, Jay, where do I start? You know, what's step one? And, you know, and that's the thing, you know, they want steps 1 through 20 right away. Like, how do I, what's step one? Like, you know what? Let's shake some hands. Forget step 20 and 30. We'll get there, but just let's do step one. Go out, shake some hands. Hey, I'm Nick. I'm new. You know, I hear you've done some deals, and you don't have to go to the top of the chart. Just find a guy that's done a couple deals and be like, hey, what are you working on? Can I buy you lunch? One thing I've learned in life, if you get interested in them and truly, I'm not saying stroke their ego and put them on a pedestal, but let them know you're sincerely intrigued and interested in who they are, and that you're congratulatory of their success and you're happy for them and you want to buy them lunch or things like that. They're going to open up to you. They may not spill all this quote unquote secrets or whatever, but they like eager new people. It's fun. I mean, Jay, you know, I mean, when people come to you for mentorship, just like they come to me, it's a satisfying feeling to know that you are helping someone new,
right?
You know, the mentor gets just as much or more out of the relationship than the mentee, believe it or not, for those listening. I believe that.
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know? Absolutely. Which brings up what I think to be a very interesting topic, because one of the things that I get asked a lot, and I'm sure, and I can only imagine you're going to get asked this probably 3 more times today as well, is, you know, they go, Jay, can I do this? And my response has been consistent. I tell people, no, you can't. The version of you standing in front of me can't do this. You need to become a new you, and then yes, you can then execute the strategies and make those things happen. And with that being said, I'm curious has personal development even played a role in your growth or the growth of anyone that you've seen or worked with over time?
Yes. And by the way, I love what you just said. Your answer is gold. Seriously, I really like the way you put that. I might copy you. I'm not gonna lie. I might steal that from you. That is gold. But yes, personal development. I've been listening to what got me into personal development. I started listening to Tony Robbins when I was a teenager. I'm a fan of the guy. I think he's great. I think he's helped a lot of people, and I like his work. And one thing going back in my teenage years as in network marketing, they really were heavy on personal development. In fact, one of the companies was called Amway, for those listening, and then it turned into a company called Quickstar, and they were heavy. We had tapes, cassette tapes, and we had, you know, they wanted you to listen to one a day, and the obsessive freak that I was listened to, you know, multiple tapes per day. So I got really kind of obsessed with personal development in my teenage years. And yeah, I mean, it's like anything else. You know, you have, if you're not growing, you're dying. You have to be improving or you're going to be falling behind. It's like a muscle or anything else. You got to exercise your mind and your psychology. You know, your mind's a garden. Weeds are always going to grow. Okay. You have to actively plant the right seeds and prune your garden, you know, because the weeds are passively going to grow without you even trying. And that's a problem, because that, you know, the weeds are negative thoughts, you know, negative mindsets, pessimism and things like that. If you want to be optimistic and, you know, have things go your way, I mean, there's no question that people who have a more positive outlook get quote unquote lucky. Now, I'm not one to talk about lucky. Nobody's lucky. Everyone creates their luck. You know what? People that have an optimistic look and, you know, are friendly and smile to people and create real genuine relationships, they look lucky. I'm not going to lie. They look lucky. I know they're not, because I know what they're doing to get there. But if you want to be lucky and get lucky on a consistent basis, start looking at things a completely different way. So the way you said, you cannot get to where you want to go, you have to change your psychology, mindset, and yourself, and then that person can get there. I love it. I absolutely love it, Jay.
Well, and turnabout being fair play, that comment about weeds always growing. Yes, I'll give you credit once. After that, it's all me. So just keep that in mind. Now, one of the things that I love that I think I want to also mention is this obsession that you have, that I think I have, that I think anyone of any import has with consuming others' ideas. And sometimes people think there's no value, you know, to actually consuming others' ideas. And I want you everybody to hear that he said he had, they wanted him to listen to one, but that wasn't enough. And when you become, or as you're becoming that person, you develop this appetite for others' ideas. And at the end of the day, all I'm after is one idea. Just give me one from every new relationship, from every new event. It doesn't really matter. I just need one. And as a side note for everyone, cassette tapes are right there with pagers. They were what came before the CD. So if you don't know what that is, then it's okay. We have these devices today. It was long before podcasting. Long before.
Yes, exactly. And if you didn't, and to rewind them, sometimes you need to use a pencil. So, hey, if you're old enough, you get me. If not, look it up sometime and have some fun with it.
I know, right? They're like, pin a what?
Wait, rewind?
Rewind, yes. Yeah, How do you do that? How do you do that? You can't skip chapters? No.
You're right.
Well, We don't do that. With all of those things being said, Nick, share with us, if you will, how can we find out more about what you're up to? Do you have anything that would help us become bigger, better, badder investors? You know, what do we want to do? What do you want us to do if we want to reach out to you and find out some more?
Well, I have a blog site at alphahomeflipping.com, and I talk about entrepreneurship. In general, I talk about real estate entrepreneurship, doing deals, nuts and bolts stuff from my story and journey. And a lot of that stuff I share in email, too, if you become an email subscriber. But, you know, really, the book is launching the first week of December. And I want to extend something special here to the Cashflow Diary special audience members. Anyone who buys the book, and I think it's going to be around $19 or something, is going to get $300 in freebies and bonuses. Okay. You just would send me your receipt to nick@alphahomeflipping.com, mention Cashflow Diary, and boom, you'll see what's up from there. But, you know, that's the main thing. I really want to truly help people with this book, and not only inspire and motivate them with my story, but then really roll into how to do this. You know, how do you structure the offer? How do you find your buyers? How do you find the sellers that can sell at a discount? How do you line up the title company? How do you actually transact these deals? You know, do you do simultaneous closings? Do you assign the rights over to them? And it sounds all complicated, but it really is broken down in a very, very easy to read and easy to follow way, step by step. And I teach you how to be an entrepreneur in the book. You know, like you said, Jay, being an entrepreneur starts in your brain. And then you go out in the world and do the actual entrepreneurial acts. But if you're not right in your mind, forget about it.
Got that right. Awesome, sir. We definitely appreciate the time that you have invested here with us. Thank you very much.
Jay, I appreciate you having me. It's been a blast, man.
All right, everybody, you know what it is time to do. It is time for you to move at the speed of instruction. What does that mean today? That means you probably want to go over to Alpha Home Flipping. You probably want to get a copy of the book. You probably want to make sure that you are out there taking action, developing your mind, becoming a different person so that you can see different results. I've had fun talking to you guys again. I look forward to talking to you soon. Until next time.